At the beginning of the episode, I said, like, hey, if you really love this class, maybe just turn this off. Just put a disclaimer on there. Say, or just take that out. Just take that out. Yeah. Like, listen to it. There's some nuance to the conversation, and you should be a part of it. How about that?
Yeah.
Put that as the cold open. That way the people at the beginning know.
Welcome to Monsters and Multiclass, your Dungeons & Dragons fix. I'm Kevin Odie.
I'm Jared Bornigal.
And I'm Will Meldon.
And we'll be hanging out with you for a while to talk about anything and everything D&D related. On this episode, we are taking a look at the new Bard subclass added in Van Richten's Guide to Ravenloft, the College of Spirits, all about talking to spirits and tarot cards and spooky stuff and randomness that we hate and we'll get into for spoiled episode, I'm sorry. Jared, take it away.
With such a smooth segue, I will definitely grab it. So, yes, we were discussing the Bard College of Spirits. So, a genuinely new take on the Bard. There's no attachment to music or even performance, I don't feel. But this Bard pulls on spirits with tarot cards. There's no pronounced T at the end there.
Yeah.
Crystal balls and anything else that you'd find at a house with a poster board sign written in Sharpie that reads palm readings, walk-ins welcome. And I'm not sure if I'd have jumped to Bard for this class. Maybe Wizard? I don't know if that entirely would have fit, but
Warlock.
What's that?
Warlock.
Warlock, yeah, that could have been good too.
The other subclass in Van Richten's is also a warlock, so...
Yeah, so maybe they should have just had two warlock subclasses. But really, I mean, I'm fine with it. I like when subclasses are entirely different directions and kind of a spin on their normal flavor. We haven't talked about the Wildfire Druid yet, but I feel like that's going to fall into that as well, at least somewhat. But either way, Bard, Spirits... I'm at least, you know, sold right from the start on that.
I find the art a little confusing. If you're on YouTube, it's probably up on the screen already right now. Where with the new subclasses, they do like a character drawing of the sort of like stereotypical version of that subclass. And it's like an older woman in this really big flowy dress with the tarot card and spirit behind her. And like, this is supposed to be an adventurer. Like, this is a PC.
Yeah.
Like, can you see her in that dress going in and delving dungeons? And
probably not. And they usually do feel a little bit more dungeon delvey ready. But I will say that this is for, you know, Van Richten's Guide to Ravenloft. And that is a very gothic horror feel. And I will say she fits that aspect, at least. That's a gothic
dress. Defend a town from werewolves.
I mean, maybe she's got this giant astral warrior behind her. So, you know,
sure, it's the dress that's tripping me up. That's like just not a practical thing to wear for vampire and werewolf hunting.
Well, underneath it, she's got, you know, leather armor, so it's fine.
Right, okay.
And it's not a practical subclass for playing Dungeons and Dragons, so it's honestly kind of a good balance. I'm just going to preface this entire episode by saying I don't like the randomness of this class. One of the things it mentions in the initial flavor is that they will summon spirits, though such spirits are capricious and not entirely under the Bard's control. So they took that and really ran with it and made this very random buff table that, you know, we'll talk about the specifics on. But if you are coming to this because you really, really like that aspect of the Bard, I don't usually tell people to turn off the video. I'm not going to say that. Maybe you'll see our point of view, and that's great. But just recognize there might be some initial bias, because I just don't like that right off the bat. Maybe Will will like it, and we'll have some great discussion there. But he usually just hates everything, so... just... All right. So let's get into it for real, starting with Guiding Whispers, the third level feature. You can reach out to spirits to guide you and others. You learn the Guidance cantrip, which doesn't count against the number of Bard cantrips you know, and for you, it has a range of 60 feet when you cast it. So that's actually pretty good. I think that's great. Yeah. Guidance is a very, very good cantrip that's used all the time. And
right.
I won't say that a 60-foot range is, or the touch range is like a huge limitation, but it comes up.
It definitely can be. Yeah, guidance is an action that casts a concentration for a minute. It is cantrip. In the whoever you cast it on, for the next ability roll they make, they get at the D4.
Yeah.
Do it.
So I can definitely say there's been times where, you know, somebody's just even 10 feet away and it's like, oh, I'd love to give you guidance, but I can't because I can't, you know, get to you. Great. Now you can.
Right.
Another time where I think it comes up is casting guidance in the middle of a conversation is something that people will often do, but guidance is not a, guidance has components. It has verbal components and somatic components, which means that you're going mm-hmm. to be speaking and waving your hands around. And so if you're doing that in the middle of a conversation, people are going to get a little bit weirded out. I will often give disadvantage on checks if you're casting guidance in the middle of a conversation, because using magic to affect social encounters is generally frowned upon by the opposing party. So if your bard wants to like hide in a closet or 60 feet away, maybe they can get away with it now.
Mm-hmm. And it's just also flavorful using the spirits to guide you and others. So just flavor it as, yeah, spirit comes on. It helps with whatever it is.
Exactly.
The person seeking guidance on. If it's all they got at third level, it would be very disappointing. But yeah, yes. There's other stuff to get here as well. So it's solid.
Yeah.
Can't complain. Bards normally don't get guidance, so.
Do they not? Can they not get it? Oh, they can't. Cleric
Druid's an artificer. Yeah.
Oh, okay. And, you know, it doesn't count against the other cantrips they know. So it's mm-hmm. just a free one, not even like expanded spell list stuff. Next thing is spiritual focus. So this just changes what they can use as their foci. Focuses? Whatever.
I don't think it's foci.
That is definitely a word, just not in this context. So, yeah, they can just use different spellcasting focuses. A candle, crystal ball, skull, spirit board, or Taroka deck. So I'm assuming that's a tarot deck, but I don't know how to pronounce it, so apologies.
It was the deck from Castle Ravenloft.
Oh, okay. So I thought you were about to say...
They made it a big
tarot like,
card deck.
Okay.
Specifically for that adventure.
That's the one that you like draw from that determines the entire adventure. That was a cool... Mm-hmm. That was a neat way of doing it. I thought you were going to say that's the deck from Cabin in the Woods. And I was like, that's generally like a half parody, so I don't know if that helps. So yeah, this just changes then what... You can use your spellcasting focus, not really a huge deal, but, you know, nice flavor. At 6th level, it does get an added benefit where if you cast a spell through a bard spell that deals damage or restores hit points through the spiritual focus, you can roll a d6 and you gain a bonus to one damage or healing roll of the spell equal to the number rolled. So that on paper sounds pretty good. But there's a little bit of controversy around this in the rules as written community. A lot of spells don't have material components. And officially, if you don't have material components, it's not being cast through your spiritual focus. The two important ones, Healing Word and Cure Wounds, don't have material components. So rules as written, the focus can only replace material components. Can't give the extra d6 to those two spells, as well as a lot of damage spells that don't have material components. Definitely doesn't feel like rules is intended to me.
Yeah.
And
yeah, I didn't consider that. I just read it and assumed it meant like if you have it on you and you cast a bard spell, it happens.
Right. But the specific wording is when you cast a bard spell that deals damage or restores HP through the spiritual focus. And you can't just choose to use material components if they're not required. Again, rules is written, like based on just exactly...
Is that rules is written?
Yeah. Yes.
You can't choose to use material components?
I mean, they're not doing anything, so...
Okay.
That's like...
At no point, I don't think at any point, I'm not going to say with 100% certainty, but I don't think at any point it says that line, you cannot choose to.
Right.
But it also doesn't give you rules to say, yeah, if you want to, you could throw in some material components and... Like, it doesn't have any rules for it, which generally means just, no, you can't do it.
Right. The only ruling, you know, like, is that...
They can't lay out every single thing you can and cannot do in the world.
Correct. The only ruling is that under the material component section, when it says that a spell requires material components, you are able to replace those with a focus. Doesn't say that for somatic. It doesn't say that for verbal. Just says it for material. So, again, rules as written, I think this isn't super great. I mean, I'm sure there's a couple healing spells out there that have material components. I'm sure there's damage spells. There's plenty of damage spells that have material components. So if somebody's a real stickler, this will still come up. But to me, this really shines when you're able to add it on to those two spells, Cure Wounds and Healing Word. And I'm just double checking right
the,
now.
That's the worst thing. I'm just no.
No, in what way?
It's not through your Taroka Day. It's through your Taroka Day.
That's why I'm saying I don't think anybody sane is going to sit there and like really fight back against that one. It's just poor wording. And I think, you know, not to be mean to giant mega corporation Hasbro, but it's a bit of sloppy writing. When people do look for these things and look for rules to be kind of airtight, and this game has been out for so long, I just kind of expect things like that to be caught in the playtesting phase and everything. I don't know.
Yeah. What's the wording for artificers? I'm pulling it up now. Because they have stuff like that.
They do, yes.
When you, like the artillerist.
And I think the arcane alchemist.
You know how to turn, yeah. You could use your arcane firearm to spellcasting focus for your artificer spells when you cast an artificer spell through the firearm. It's the same wording.
Yeah, same wording. So
roll a d8 and gain bonus. Yeah.
So that, I think, is less of a problem because most damage spells have material components. But I'd have to, you know, look through one by one to make a call on that. I know that the alchemist can do it for healing as well. So cure wounds can come up for that. And I think it's the same wording, again, through... So, just a small thing. Again, I think at the table, people are going to use common sense, but yeah.
If someone tries to stop you from doing this, I authorize you to physically engage them in combat.
Roll initiative, sir. But I will say, at 6th level, being able to add a d6 to a damage roll or a healing roll is really, really good. So I like that ability as it is intended.
Assuming how it's intended, yeah.
Yes.
And no limit on it, no resources used. Nice solid little buff.
And then we get to their really unique thing. And this is, you know, all bards get their own way of using Bardic Inspiration, a major class feature. And this gets Tales from Beyond. So you reach out to spirits who tell their tales through you. While you are holding your spiritual focus, you can use a bonus action to expend one use of your Bardic Inspiration and roll on the Spirit Tales table, using your Bardic Inspiration die to determine the tale the spirits direct you to tell. You retain the tale in mind until you bestow the tale's effect or you finish a short or long rest. You can use an action to choose one creature you can see within 30 feet of you, which can be yourself, to be the target of the tale's effect. Once you do so, you can't bestow the tale's effect again until you roll it again. You can retain only one of these tales in mind at a time, and rolling on the spirit table immediately ends the effect of the previous tale. If the tale requires a saving throw, the DC equals your spell save DC. So let's break that down. That was a lot of talking there. The basic idea is that...
It's third level, by the way.
Yeah.
You didn't say level. Yeah. Yeah, it's at third level.
I said that. Play the tapes. Someone go back. Play the tapes. And then
it's a lot of work. So
I know. I know you won't do it. But everybody else, right now, you pause it and you go back 30 seconds to see if I set a level. So it takes a bonus action use of your Bardic Inspiration, which is pretty common. Usually that's going to be a bonus action. And then you roll on this spirits table, which has 1 through 12. Seeing as your Bardic Inspiration die starts at 6, obviously you can only get up to there until your Bardic Inspiration die increases all the way to 12. You can't access those ones. Some nice built-in scaling.
Yes, I do like that design. Overall, I don't like this feature, but I like that little design mechanic there, where as they get higher in number, they do get better
mm-hmm.
for the most part. And it just kind of automatically gates it based on, yeah, your bardic inspiration die. I didn't have to do separate tables based on level or anything like that.
Yeah, totally agree.
So that was a clever little design.
Agreed. And then, so that stays in your head until you want to use it. And when you do want to use this effect, it now takes an action to start it or to use it. It's kind of all over the place with what these do. And, you know, you've heard us at the start here saying that we don't like this feature. The reason why is because these buffs are really all over the place. And it takes a lot of setup for something that's just random and, in my opinion, doesn't need to be random.
Right, and an entire action.
Yeah.
Like, most of these are not so good to take your entire action in combat. But then some of them are out of combat.
Right. So
then I guess that doesn't matter.
I think, like, one of them's out of combat. And that makes it even worse, in my opinion. Yeah, because because now you, like, you can't even be consistent. You can't say, oh, this is my combat ability. You, like, roll it at the beginning of the day, maybe, which you have to expend a bardic inspiration for, and maybe it's going to be an all combat day, and you roll a one. Okay, well, my bardic inspiration was just wasted and no longer has a use. And some of the other ones just, I don't know. I mean, they're all over the place in play style. And the idea is that you can give it to other people. Sometimes that might work. Sometimes it might not. I don't know.
Yeah. And before we dive into the individual table here, just to talk a bit where this obviously is very reminiscent of the Wild Magic Sorcerer or the new Barbarian Natasha's The Path of the Wild Magic, where it's kind of the same thing. And we've talked about liking those. Some complaints and things like that, but we definitely do not hate those as much as we hate this. And the big difference for me is the Wild Magic Sorcerer and the Path of Wild Magic Barbarian is the randomness is an additional effect on already doing something good. The sorcerer casts a spell and then they roll on the wild magic table. It happens after the spell takes effect, that you cannot take that away from them. The sorcerer gets to cast their spell and then this random thing happens, which may be good or bad. Same with the barbarian. They rage and you don't, like, they get all the benefits of rage. They don't lose that. You can't take it away from them. And then after their rage goes up, they get one of the random benefits. So you at least always have this base thing for resource, which for using the resources with the College of Spirits here, you are using a limited resource of your Bardic Inspiration die, which I think just equals your Charisma modifier.
Yeah.
If I'm remembering correctly.
Yeah.
And that's it. Like, you're just using that up to hopefully get a good effect. There's nothing else you have. So it could be a complete 100% waste. I don't know if I would ever risk wasting them. Like, I'm playing a Valor Bard right now, and I pretty much will always go through all of my Bardic Inspiration.
Yeah. Yeah, and even at 14th level, like all of these random classes, at the higher levels, you get to roll twice and ignore the one that you don't want, so you get a little bit better of a chance of getting one that's worthwhile. But that's 14th level. That's a very, very long time to wait just to get a little bit better of an option. Now, I hate to compare it to such a obviously sky blue tier class, the Alchemist. So the Alchemist also actually has a random table similar to this, where they get a random potion once per day. Difference is, the Alchemist gets the potion for free on a long rest. They get at least one. That might end up going up, I forget. So they start with one random, and then if they want to do another potion, they can expend a spell slot, first level, a resource, and choose off that table which one they get. If this followed that same pattern, where once a day you get one for free and it's random, and if you expend a bardic inspiration, then you can choose, I wouldn't be nearly as upset.
Right.
And I think that, you know, maybe that changes the balance around. Maybe you have to make some of these a little less powerful, and that's totally fine, because there's just no reason to have this level of randomness in it. And if you want to have some randomness, you already have an example of how it can work. Now, I was being sarcastic about Alchemist being, like, really, really good. To anybody who has not listened to the show before, Alchemist is not amazing. That's a joke. Please don't bring out the pitchforks. But it at least has that ability, and that setup, that mechanic is worthwhile and does present a way of doing this that keeps some randomness without it being so restricting.
Right. Yeah, I would have loved to see that style apply to this. But it's not what we got.
It's not what we got.
But it's definitely not a bad homebrew fix if someone like wants to play this.
Yeah, I think I'd probably...
I don't think that would break anything.
I don't think so either, because it's just one additional use of it. And again, it's going to be random, so they might just say, oh, I don't like this one. And then, okay, fine, just spend it and get the one that you do want. And you can still keep that gate of, you know, 1 through 5, you only get up to 6th level, and then... Once you get your Bardic Inspiration die, you can choose 7 and 8 and so on and so forth.
Right.
So maybe my opinion on that will change. I've looked through these. I've read through them a couple of times. But I find when we talk about these large tables together, I figure out a little bit more about it than I initially get on my own read. So let's start with that. The Spirit Tales. The first one is Tale of the Clever Animal. So this is the only non-combat one. For the next 10 minutes, whenever the target makes an intelligence, wisdom, or charisma check, the target can roll an extra die immediately after rolling the d20 and add the extra die's number to the check. The extra die is the same type as your Bardic Inspiration die. So keep in mind, what does Bardic Inspiration do, everybody?
Allows you to add
any check.
Checks.
Yeah. So yes, great. This does it for 10 minutes. So if you're in a social encounter, then you have... an extra D6, 8, 10, 12. I mean, that's pretty nice. But that's what Bardic Inspiration just does.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and then they can hold on to it for 10 minutes. So, I mean, it lets you do a few more. But usually these checks are not like rapid fire like
no,
that.
No. Roll a persuasion check. Roll a deception check. Come on. Go, go, go.
Right.
You know, you might have one or two. And that's fine. But... I would hate to get this one every single time.
Right.
And even more, I get the feeling that you might not even know it's going to come up. So like, I don't know, you're just in a conversation and you're not thinking, oh, this is going to be the conversation that we need to persuade this person. Today's the day where I roll the one. And because I roll the one, that means that I know I've got this, you know, 10 minutes add a Bardic Inspiration die to... my social skills.
Mm-hmm.
Like the check's going to come up and then you as the bard, you're going to say, ooh, can I use my Tale of the Clever Animal and give them Bardic Inspiration for the next 10 minutes now that I realize that we're rolling? And that feels weird. That's a bad mechanic.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, I'm with you on that one.
Right out the gate.
It's pretty shit.
Yeah. all right, so then 2 is Tale of the Renowned Duelist. You make a melee spell attack against the target. On a hit, the target takes force damage equal to 2 rolls of your Bardic Inspiration die plus your Charisma modifier.
A little bit of damage.
Yeah. Have to be within 5 feet, which is okay. Yeah. Probably not where I'd want this bard to be, but that's not like that big of a deal. It's going to happen, so that's okay.
Right. So,
but it does as much damage as a cantrip.
Yeah, say your whole action. Or like a greatsword, 2d6 plus. Yeah, then it does go up, but then also your cantrips.
Yeah, I mean,
go up.
Bards get. I mean, Vicious Mockery is like a common bard one. Is that I always forget. Is that the cantrip?
That's a d4. That's cantrip.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's obviously really low, but they still get.
But it adds disadvantage.
Yeah. Actually, before I go on a rant here, what other cantrips do bards get? I don't look at damage-dealing bard cantrips that much.
Not a lot.
Yeah, I know that's not, like, no. Their thing.
It's a little bit like druids. They were not designed to be cantrip blasters.
Which is reasonable.
Just Vicious Mockery.
Yeah, okay, alright, so it's a little bit more powerful than a bard cantrip, but Vicious Mockery imposes disadvantage on the next attack. So
right, or they could just shoot him with a crossbow,
or they can just shoot him with a crossbow. Yeah, it's not that much damage. It's okay.
No,
I would rather add a d6 to a saving throw. a normal use of my bardic inspiration.
Right, yeah.
Oh, this is just going to get worse, isn't it? All right. Three is Tale of the Beloved Friends. The target and another creature of its choice it can see within 5 feet of it gain temp HP equal to a roll of your bardic inspiration die plus your charisma modifier.
This one's solid.
Yeah.
Like, temp HP doesn't really go away. I think it goes away in a long rest. I'm not even 100% sure if that's the case.
I'm pretty sure.
But either way, you know, start the day with, and you roll this one, and you just give it out to someone in your party right away, and then they have it.
Yeah, I'm not going to wait until combat to waste an action.
Right. And it has potential to get up there. So this one, I'm okay with this one. This one is not complete shit.
I agree. And it's two creatures. So
yeah,
that works out really, really well. Even at low levels, you're averaging, what, 6 temp HP if your charisma's +3 and you roll a 3 on your D6. That's pretty good. And that only goes up. I mean, really, that can get pretty absurd. Once you're at the D12 range, you're now talking about 17. 12 plus 5. Yeah, 17 temp HP to two people. Yeah, that's worthwhile.
Right.
I wish I could choose that. Four is Tale of the Runaway. The target can immediately use its reaction to teleport up to 30 feet to an unoccupied space it can see. When the target teleports, it can choose a number of creatures it can see within 30 feet of it up to your charisma modifier to immediately use the same reaction. This one's not too bad either. I could see using a action to then spend a reaction to teleport and let other people teleport with their reaction. Personally, don't know if it needs to use the reaction. Maybe just let it be the action and move on.
Well, you could do it on someone else.
I know, but like you're already spending your action. Why does like it just compounds?
I'm just trying to think. Like it kind of competes a Misty Step, which is a bonus action. I know this allows you to take people with you, but that's actually pretty rare.
Being able to take somebody?
I think.
Dimension Door lets
needing
you.
Needing to. Yeah, like needing to do it. I guess out of combat for like infiltration, getting over a 30-foot chasm. Well, if you like happen to roll it, you know.
Well, I think what's important is you're not taking them with you. You're allowing them to also teleport. So I would say it is a free positioning and free-ish. You're spending your action and your reaction. Or somebody else is spending their reaction. Multiple people are spending their reaction in order to position well. So that's okay. It's just the fact that it takes an action to give it and expend it in the first place and then a reaction. That's the only part that I take issue with. Like, it's just once again that idea of would it really be broken if this ability that you'll probably get once per day is letting you teleport 30 feet, you and up to your charisma modifier, teleport 30 feet without using a reaction. Is that like, oh my god, this game's totally broken. This class is ridiculous. Eh.
Right.
But there are bigger fish to fry.
Yeah. Or make it a bonus action to apply this stuff.
Sure.
Instead of a full action.
And that's,
I think it should be reversed. Use an action to draw a card and, you know, call on the spirit and then a bonus action to apply its effect.
I get why they didn't, because that's out of the norm of bardic inspiration. It's always a bonus action to expend it. So I get where they're coming from, but I'm sure. With you. I think you're right. I think this is the one time where just make it an action because it's probably happening outside of combat. And in combat, now it's a bonus action to give it, which is actually more in line with a bardic inspiration because usually you're giving it in combat as a bonus action.
Right.
Five, Tale of the Avenger. For 1 minute, any creature that hits the target with a melee attack takes force damage equal to a roll of your bardic inspiration die.
So that's fantastic. That's great.
All right.
Use that one all the time. Put it on your fighter or whoever.
Yeah, that's a great one. And only gets better as you level up, as the bardic inspiration die goes up.
Yep, no reaction or anything.
That is worth an action to do, because I could see that being a spell. And I would say, oh, that's a pretty good spell. Like, that's like a third level spell. No concentration, too. That's pretty good.
Right.
All right, 6, we get Tale of the Traveler. The target gains temp HP equal to a roll of your Bardic Inspiration die plus your Bard level. While it has these temp HP, the target's walking speed increases by 10 feet and gives it a +1 bonus to its AC.
I would say another solid one.
Yeah.
The temp HP plus 1 to AC. 10-foot walking speed increase.
Yeah, my only issue is I just don't like when things go away when temp HP goes away, because you can't choose to have your normal HP go away first. So you might end up with, like, I don't know, 10 temp HP, get it taken out in one turn before your round even starts, and then you lose the cool stuff before it even happens.
Right. So. Yeah, that is a fair point. This is another one of those where it's kind of almost just cast it right away.
Good point.
If you get it, though, then it's just up.
Right, right. Where you just don't want to do that in combat. So that honestly is a point in its favor, in my opinion, is if you can use these before combat and know the person has it before combat starts, that is a win. It would be quite a bummer, though, if, I don't know, for example, you had, like, let's say 15 temp HP, and then first round you rolled mediocre on initiative and then took 60 plus damage in one turn, then it's gone. Right.
Yeah. Or, well, traveling to the random encounter, falling and taking 2d6 bludgeoning damage from your fall.
Yeah. It's like, oh, it's gone. Goodbye, temp HP.
Yep. So those are the first 6, which are the, when you get this, are the ones you'll have access to. And I'd say it's about 50-50 in terms of quality.
Yeah.
Which, again, though, when it's not just like a free thing you get in addition to it, but you have to spend resources to have the privilege to hope you get one of the good ones. It's just like, I feel so bad.
Yeah. Yeah, not a big fan of lottery classes.
Right. I think this is the only one really like this. All the other random ones, it's... You get your free... You get the benefit of whatever you're doing, and then here's a free randomness added on top.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I think this is... If there are others, they don't suffer nearly as badly as this. All right, so to 7, we got Tale of the Beguiler. The target must succeed on a wisdom saving throw or take psychic damage equal to 2 rolls of your Bardic Inspiration die, and the target is incapacitated until the end of its next turn. That one's pretty good.
Yeah, incapacitated for a round. Oddly enough, you don't get like advantage or anything on those attacks, but...
On incapacitated people?
Yeah.
Yeah, they just can't take actions or reactions.
Yeah.
I'm okay with that.
But, yeah.
Forcing them to lose a turn.
Right. Fully gated behind a wisdom save, and so it's kind of very much a save or suck, doesn't all half damage or... Anything like that.
Yeah. The way that
I'm just trying to think of it's... It's basically trading your action for their action.
Yeah, I guess it... Because it does take your entire action.
And that's not a bad trade in most combats.
Yeah, it depends where you're fighting. Big monster of multi-attack, yeah.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
The way that I've been trying to frame these is if I could see it being a spell... And that spell actually would get used, then to me, this is all right. It's an all right ability. I could see this being a second level spell where you have them make a wisdom save. On a fail, they take 2d8 and are incapacitated until the end of their next turn. Yeah, I'd use that spell.
Yeah, I can see that.
But, you know, you're not wrong. You're trading actions, which it has to be the right situation. It wouldn't be good against a mob, a trash mob. It's... great against a, you know, single enemy if you've got the big bad evil guy and 5 minions. Well, if you can get the big bad evil guy to lose their actions and reactions, and I am pretty sure, somebody correct me if I'm wrong, incapacitated removes a creature's ability to take legendary actions. I'm pretty sure. So that could be huge there if they fail, but it's a wisdom save, so... Big bad evil guys with low wisdom generally aren't going to be big bad evil guys for long.
No, yeah. it does end concentration on spells and things like that.
Oh, yeah. Incapacitated. That's a really good point. Yeah, incapacitated does a lot more than it says.
Right. Yeah, there's a lot of other things where it says, like, you're in this state unless you become... It ends early if you're incapacitated, such as, like, concentration, rage, yeah. Maybe it's just those two. I can't think of a specific ruling on legendary actions, but it says cannot take actions, plural, and the interpretation of that is bonus actions are included in that. And so I would imagine legendary actions are also included in that.
Yes, Monster Manual, page 11. I just looked that up. So a legendary creature can take a certain number of special actions called legendary actions outside its turn. Reading forward to the important part, it isn't required to use its legendary actions, and it can't use legendary actions while incapacitated.
Yeah.
So that could be a major benefit if you can pull it off. It's at least worth it. Would definitely burn a legendary resistance if they fail and have that.
Right. Yeah, for sure.
All right. 8, Tail of the Phantom. The target becomes invisible until the end of its next turn or until it hits a creature with an attack. If the target hits a creature with an attack during this invisibility, the creature it hits takes necrotic damage equal to a roll of your Bardic Inspiration die and is frightened of the target until the end of the frightened creature's turn. Definitely would be good to cast on your rogue.
Sure. The frightened condition's always a little weak.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I guess you would impose one round of disadvantage.
Yeah, and that's basically
that creature. That's about it. You do a bit of extra necrotic damage, and then, yeah, like a free invisibility. It's okay.
Yeah.
Not an amazing one, but, you know, if you got this, you'd use it. It wouldn't be wasted.
Yeah, I will say, I mean, I guess anybody with a martial character would really benefit from this.
So, that being said, again, it takes the bard's entire action, and then invisibility only lasts at the end of its next turn, the target's next turn. So this has to be in combat. This is not something you do before combat, and they get to walk around invisible all day.
True.
It's a 6-second
yeah, and, you know,
thing, and it's your entire action to impose the frightened condition, maybe, on one creature and do a bit of extra necrotic damage.
To compare it to a spell, invisibility, that lasts until you take an attack. Obviously, it lasts, I think, 10 minutes otherwise. Now, I don't see invisibility, normal invisibility, just getting right. much use in combat. Greater invisibility is an amazing spell, but that's 5th level, not 2nd. Invisibility isn't generally
hour,
worth it.
Way.
Oh, it's an hour. Okay, so yeah, that's usually used out of combat for somebody trying to sneak around or trying to make the entire party invisible, because I think you can upcast it on more people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that gets a lot of use out of combat. This is like, hey, what if invisibility also let you do some extra damage and potentially let you impose the frightened condition? So I will say one benefit to this, no concentration.
Sure.
So, yeah, I think you're still right. It's going to get use. It's not the best one. It's not amazing.
Yeah. Again, with sacrificing your entire action, I don't know if it's going to get used. A bonus action? Absolutely.
Yeah.
You could do this for a bonus action. The bard's entire action? I don't know if it's really worth it in the middle of combat.
What are bards even doing with their actions? Singing? Dancing?
Mocking people viciously?
Seducing dragons? I don't know. Will, when you were playing a bard warlock, what did you do most turns?
Spamming that anime spell.
Oh, it was like Zephyr Strike?
Steel Wind Strike.
Yeah.
That's a high level
one. Nothing personal, kid.
Yeah.
But that's a better use of my action than turning someone invisible for one round.
What if... Wait, is until the end of their next turn? It is. So you could make yourself invisible and then cast your... No, once you cast the spell... It goes away. Oh, actually, it says until it hits a creature with an attack. So you could cast a spell. This is such a specific scenario. This does not give any more credit to this ability. But you could, in theory, as the bard, cast it on yourself, this Tail of the Phantom, become invisible, at next turn do your Steel Wind Strike, and the first one would have advantage. Then you make the attack and continue to do your anime teleports and make more jumps. And that first one would get the extra necrotic damage and the potential frightened. Not saying that gives it credit or that it's better, just a cool use of it. Two turns to set up.
Yeah, you knew how else you could guarantee yourself advantage at the true strike cantrip.
But that doesn't
Which everyone says it's just like terrible. Like, never use that. It's never worth the entire action to give yourself advantage on your next turn.
But this also gives necrotic damage and
one extra 1d8. Sure.
I'll say this. There's a timing element to this one that makes it a little better. And that's if, let's say, your tank is getting the shit beat out of him. Now he'll be less shit beat out of him because of disadvantage.
There you go. And can't take opportunity attacks against him. So if you need to get somebody out of a bad situation, maybe that's
this is a mediocre way to do it.
But that's where just casting invisibility comes in, or the tank disengaging. Yeah, there are definitely benefits of becoming invisible in combat, where you no longer take opportunity attacks, a whole bunch of spells can no longer target you, things like that. But yeah, this is just 6 seconds. Like, if they're in that extreme of a situation, they're probably going to want it to last, where they get invisibility cast on them, and then they spend like a few rounds getting to safety.
Kevin, it's about getting to the next round, all right? If it's about getting to the next round and keeping your barbarian up, then this might do it.
Right.
No, I'm with you. I think there's a couple of niche uses where you're going to say, oh, great, I've got that Tale of the Phantom. But realistically, you're going to just waste an action and potentially just not use this to any real benefit. And when the benefit or the opportunity does come up that it would be beneficial, you already used it for something sillier.
Right. Or you rolled one of the other 7 things.
Or you rolled one of the other, at some right. point,
yeah,
12
it's like,
things.
All right, so, yeah, we're talking like, all right, here's these kind of weird situations where it could work, but that does happen from time to time. But in addition it needs to line up with when you rolled this.
Yeah.
And I've not used it previously. So that goes back to, I guess in theory, you could do an entire turn of combat to bonus action, draw on another spirit, happen to roll this one, and then action apply it, and that's one round. But again, it's like, is that worth that risk? You know, you're just going to roll number one and
right.
give somebody a bonus to intelligence, wisdom, and charisma checks.
How mad would you be? I mean, seriously, right? You'd be like, I literally could have done anything else, and it would have been more worthwhile.
Right. Yeah, so yeah, if it goes back to where you could choose, you know, you get your free one, and then if you spend the bardic inspiration, you could choose. Then, yeah, you could spend your bonus action and action to pick this one and apply it when it needs to be. Hell, maybe even make it take a spell slot, like how the Alchemist does.
Sure.
Bardic inspiration, a spell slot to be able to choose, because some of these are pretty powerful, to just like be able to just pick them whenever you want.
But yeah, that becomes a little weird, because then it's like, you spend a spell slot and a bardic inspiration? It's supposed to tie to your bardic inspiration. Personally, I think if you want to do that, well, I don't know. It should have been balanced around that. So it's not my fault that I can't come up with a great fix on the fly.
Right.
All right, we got a couple more of these left. Tale of the Brute is number 9. Each creature of the target's choice it can see within 30 feet of it must make a strength saving throw. On a failed save, a creature takes thunder damage equal to 3 rolls of your bardic inspiration die and is knocked prone. A creature then that succeeds on its saving throw takes half as much damage and isn't knocked prone. So each creature of your target's choice within 30 feet, that's good. Good range. You can choose. It's not like the Graviturgy wizard that just like exploded their friends.
Right.
Strength saving throw, take it or leave it. But 3, at least D8. Oh, no, I guess D10.
D10 at this point, yeah.
Yeah.
Unless you painted a 9 on your D8s, in which case, well played.
At what point do they go up to D10s? At 10th level.
Yeah.
So I'm just, okay.
I think this is
like,
pretty
good. Like there's like the Thunderclap cantrip, which comes to mind, but that would be 3d6 at 11th. This is 3d10, and also Thunderclap does not knock anyone prone.
Correct.
There's then what? Thunder Wave, the spell.
That pushes you back 15 feet, doesn't knock you prone.
Okay.
Because we just used that the other
day. And that's 2d8 as a first level spell. Additional d8 for every slot up. And yeah.
And it has to be a cube in front of you, not a 30-foot radius centered on yourself.
Yeah.
That's a pretty wide... Okay. And you already know you have this most of the time, so you can position yourself and then use it.
Right.
And
I would say, yeah, seems well worth the action.
Yeah, and half damage on a success even. So, yeah.
Right.
I definitely give this one a big thumbs up. I guess I only have one size of thumb, so...
Right.
If I had a bigger thumb, it would get that one up.
Small thumbs, Jared, over here.
They're normal sized thumbs, all right? Look in the camera. Those are normal sized thumbs. Let's not...
It's like a pretty small thumb, man. Let's
not give me hand anxiety.
All right, small thumbs. What's number 10?
Tail of the Dragon. The target spews fire from the mouth. Okay, that's a weird way of phrasing that. Not from their mouth, just from the mouth. In a 30-foot cone. Each creature in that area must make a dexterity saving throw, taking fire damage equal to 4 rolls of the Bardic Inspiration die on a failed save, or half as much damage on a successful one. So that's 4d10.
Yeah, definitely getting better. That being said, at this point in time, bards have access to magical secrets, and so they can do stuff like grab fireball.
Yeah.
And cone of colds and...
Things
like that.
But that's a really high resource value compared to one bard inspiration.
That is very true. Or again, you roll a 1.
Yeah. And that's...
I just can't get past that. It's like, yeah, this is solid. Like number 9, number 10 here, fine. Nothing wrong with those, an action and uses a bardic inspiration. At this point, you do get back on a short rest.
Correct.
Which is nice. Early on, it's a long rest. I think level 5,
mm-hmm.
It's a short rest. But yeah, I still get hung up on it. It's like, it's like... You're not going to be getting this all the time. It's going to be...
The only benefit is at this point, as we've talked about before, you're usually going to get this out of combat to start. And then when you're in combat, you know you've got Tail of the Dragon. You can let your fighter get up close and they're in a good position. And hey, you've got Tail of the Dragon. I'm using my action. And immediately that target spews fire. So they right. don't have to then use an action.
Right, and it doesn't use the reaction either.
Right. So you're right.
It'd be a little alarming if you didn't get like a heads up about it.
Yeah.
Like, it sounds like it kind of forces the target.
Yeah. Oh, that's actually a good point. Because the target doesn't have to even be a friend. It could be an enemy. The back
line.
That's
true. Oh, yeah. You could hurt. You can use an action to choose one creature you see within 30 feet of you. This could be you to be the target of the tail's effect. Once you do so, you can't bestow, until you roll it again. Yeah, it does not say willing creature anywhere. You're right, and yeah, some of these are doing damage to people, so of course not.
Right.
So yeah, you could do this on an enemy.
That's actually really cool.
That's kind of, all right, I like that.
And yeah, I mean, honestly, I'll give that as another plus to things like Tail of the Brute, just keeping in mind that you can, there's the one where you can make the strength saving throws. Same deal. You can choose somebody who's in a better position. You don't even have to be in a good position yourself. That one, of right. course, you don't want to do an enemy because it's each creature of the target's choice. But if you don't want to be the frontliner, which you probably don't with this bard class, you can still give it to somebody who's in a better spot.
Right.
Set the fighter or the tank, whatever, the frontliners up for a really good next round.
Right.
Which, I mean... Talking about this more as we get to these like higher level ones, I definitely pull back a little bit on that. Like, yeah, just let people choose because like these ones now are starting to get so good that you would just choose that every time.
Yeah.
If I could spend a Bardic Inspiration and get that Tail of the Dragon every single time, I would be using that without a doubt. Bardic Inspiration for that much damage? Heck yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that these ones are bad. It's that, why is this up to chance? Just let it be less good and let me choose it.
This one's so... Like, as we're going through and reading this, and I did read this through beforehand, and I came away thinking, oh, this is crap and terrible for all the reasons we talked about. And now going through it again, I'm realizing a lot of these actually are very good.
Yeah.
And maybe I was a little harsh. And so I don't hate it as much, but it's... This is a tricky one. Like, I can't think of how to balance it, like a quick little easy fix.
No.
By just like redoing the entire class. And who knows? Maybe I feel like this is one we're going to need to play at some point.
That's fair.
At a bit of a higher level.
But like, also with these random classes, it's like, and over the course of months, not just like I played it as a one shot and I got 12 every. Well, I don't know what 12 is, but I got Tale of the Dragon every single time I tried to use this. It's a great class. It's like, no, that doesn't actually give you a good overview. Right. But hey, I said at the beginning, you know, I don't like it, but maybe when we talk about these tables, I feel like things come out that we did not think of just from reading it.
Right. Because, yeah, you just sit there by yourself and just read it through real fast. It's a lot to take in.
Yeah.
Missing little things.
And I also just get, you know, increasingly mad. So by the end of this table, I'm like, this is stupid. I don't want to read this anymore. Just tell me the ability and let's move on. Right. All right, we got two left. Right. Tale of the Angel is if you roll an 11. So this is now what level? What do you have to be to get?
Oh, I have it up. At 15th level, you get a D12.
Jeez. Okay, so
you're getting pretty high.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Tale of the Angel, the target regains hit points equal to two rolls of your Bardic Inspiration die plus your Charisma modifier, and you end one of the following conditions: blinded, deafened, paralyzed, petrified, or poisoned. This one actually kind of sucks.
Yeah, I feel like the health needs to be higher.
Yeah. Make it
three or even four rolls of your D12.
Yeah.
Well, then again, it is a D12 at this point. I mean, you know it's not going to be 24.
But your level 15. What's the average of?
Yeah.
How many things are putting out 20 plus damage in a single hit, let alone a round?
Right. Yeah, a lot.
And, yeah.
At this point, you could be upcasting cures and all that.
And you've got a ton of different ways to get rid of blinded, deafened, paralyzed, petrified, or poisoned.
Right. I'm pretty sure that's just exactly what's listed on
Greater Restoration. No, that's lesser. Greater.
It's greater.
That's
greater. Is it? Okay.
Yeah.
For okay. Petrified, at least. Yeah. But that doesn't come up that often.
Petrified? No.
So just to pull up Greater Restoration, you can reduce the target's exhaustion by one level. One effect that charmed or petrified, a curse, any reduction of the target's ability score, or one effect reducing the target's max HP. So this is actually very different than Greater Restoration.
And then Lesser Restoration, I have it up. It's blinded, deafened, paralyzed, or poisoned.
Okay.
So it's basically lesser restoration with petrified.
And to D12.
And
plus your charisma. So, you know, it's just okay. I guess I got a little hyped up with 9 and 10 being these like, wow, they're bringing in the heavy hitters now. This is pretty cool.
Right.
And then you get to this and it's like, okay.
Yeah. And I don't like when they combine healing and removing a condition like this, because it's pretty rare, I think, someone needs healing and to have like blinded removed. It's usually you want to do one or the other. And so then sometimes it feels a little wasted. It's like, if someone needs healing and they have no conditions on them, would you still use this just to heal them?
Right.
Or would you feel like you're kind of wasting it?
I would argue that most of the time that you have a condition on you, you've probably taken some damage. Not every time. It definitely can be like very first round of combat, you get blinded, haven't taken any hits. That happens. But to say that you don't have at least one or two hits on you, most of the time probably. But I don't think this would be worth it to just heal somebody. So you may sit on this through an entire combat waiting for that moment to come up where your healing and your condition ending is going to be worthwhile. And that might not happen.
Right.
I'll say the ones that it can end, they are good, but just Lesser Restoration is really common.
Mm-hmm.
And is also an action. So it's not like you're really gaining much there action economy wise.
Yeah, and it's a second level spell. Bards do get it.
Yeah.
Almost everybody gets it. Cleric, Druid, Paladin, Ranger, Artificer. And then, bards.
Yeah. So, I'll say it's okay. I don't think it's horrible. It's not the worst, but...
No.
Definitely not the best. All right, last one. Tale of the Mindbender. You evoke an incomprehensible fable from an otherworldly being. The target must succeed on an intelligence saving throw or take psychic damage equal to three rolls of your Bardic Inspiration die and be stunned until the end of its next turn. So,
is stunned this... is a good condition.
Yeah, but this is kind of like Tale of the Beguiler, but only a little bit better.
Yeah, it's just kind of like a souped up version of that. So they get stunned instead of incapacitated, and stunned makes them incapacitated.
And three rolls instead
also,
of two.
Also, actually, what's interesting, an incapacitated creature could still move.
Oh, yeah, they just can't take actions or reactions.
Right.
Okay.
So I think it's kind of incapacitated more like in like a stupor or like in a daze, but they could kind of move around. But yeah, stunned, can't move, and can speak only falteringly. They automatically fail strength and dex saving throws, and attack rolls against the creature have advantage.
And
that's just done.
I'll add on that it targets intelligence instead of wisdom, which is right. a lot better to target.
Right. And then you get three rolls of your bardic inspiration instead of two.
So, yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like for like number 12, like they could have came up with something a little more unique than just like, oh, let's just take this other one and soup it up a bit.
I probably would have switched around 12 and 10. Which it would just, I mean, obviously that doesn't change anything like beyond when you get access to them, which is important. Mm-hmm. But Tale of the Dragon, that one is like, that's awesome to me. I mean, again, at this point it'd be 4d12 in a 30-foot cone from whatever target you want to spew a 30-foot cone of fire. That's awesome. That is like a, yes, I got it. I got the one, guys, the one that I took this class for. Tale of the Mindbender is good, but it's not that.
Right. Because, yeah, like, stunning, like, monks have been able to do that since 5th level.
Right.
With Stunning Strike. I think that's a wisdom save, though.
Constitution.
Or con? Yeah, okay. Constitution saves are usually pretty good for monsters. So, yeah, targeting intelligence is nice.
Yeah. So, that's the table.
Yeah, that's... we're still just at 3rd level.
Well,
everything else is going to be much quicker. That was, yeah.
Yeah,
that
the rest of this cover. Is... definitely not nearly as big. But I mean, I even just to take a step back, I will say that I like this a little more than when we started talking about it.
Yes.
But I still just wish the class wasn't made like this. I just don't like all the randomness. I still would have been fine with toning some of these down, giving us 4 options even. Just 4. And maybe at you know, 3rd level, you only get access to 2, or let's say 5 options. Great. And every time your Bardic Inspiration die goes up, you get access to a new one, and you can choose it. And the more I talk about it, the more it's going to be a total rework. But right. I just don't like this type of randomness. And I think you hit the nail on the head, Kevin, when you said that it's the fact that you don't get anything else. If you get the bad random, you get that one, then, sorry, you wasted your Bardic Inspiration.
Yeah, I have nothing new to add with all that. Just, yeah, what we've said throughout. I like it better going through it again because there are a lot of really, really solid ones, but I still think it would feel pretty bad to play.
All right, so let's keep on moving here. 6th level, you get Spirit Session. Spirits provide you with supernatural insights. You can conduct an hour-long ritual channeling spirits, which can be done on a short or long rest, using your spiritual focus. You can conduct the ritual with a number of willing creatures equal to your proficiency bonus, including yourself. At the end of the ritual, you learn one spell of your choice from any class. The spell you choose must be of a level equal to the number of creatures that conducted the ritual or less. The spell must be of a level you can cast, and it must be in a school of divination or necromancy. The chosen spell counts as a bard spell for you, but not against the number of bard spells you know. And once you perform the ritual, you can't do so again until you finish a long rest. And you know the chosen spell until the start of a long rest. A lot to unpack here.
So basically, you spend an hour doing a ritual, and then you can learn a spell up to your proficiency bonus, assuming you have that many people involved.
Assuming you have that many people.
Too tough to do, especially in a full party. And then, of course, though, you need to be at the appropriate level to cast a spell, and the spell has to be divination or necromancy, and then you know it for the day, using your spell slots to cast it. Very flavorful. Sounds cool. The fact it's limited to divination and necromancy is a killer. Like, I went through... just preparing for this, all divination and necromancy spells, and most of the good ones bards already get. The biggest thing I can see using this for is you could get resurrection spells. Because those are on necromancy.
Yeah, that's pretty good. I'll give that too. I will disagree on where you said that that should be pretty easy to get up to your proficiency bonus with a full party. Once we start looking at the higher level stuff, fifth level, sixth level, I mean, yeah, that's later on, but you're not always going to have that many people around. And even more, I think this is, it spits in the face of people who play at smaller tables. Like if I just have
a
two-person D&D game, which is common and honestly really fun. If you've never played at a table with like a small group, two or three people, it's a great way to play the game. And this class gets nerfed because you made that choice, or we have to carry an NPC around with us. What was the point? Just say up to my proficiency bonus and move on with it.
Yeah, I didn't really think of that. That's, I mean, we have like five players at our table.
Right.
So I'm thinking, no, it's fine. But yeah, that's a good point. Just yesterday we did a one shot with just the three of us. Yeah, and that would have felt crappy.
Yeah, for no reason. Like, it doesn't add anything interesting. It's not like, oh man, we gotta find an NPC so I can get my sixth level spell instead of my fifth level spell. It's just kind of...
It's a flavorful thing, but it's flavorful at the expense of the player, mechanically.
Right.
Like, why would you have a seance normally? Flavor. This is a seance. Now you have, like, daily seances that you maybe rope random people into. This is not a problem if you're in town.
Yeah.
I mean, that's fun. If you're in the dungeon, you can't be like, let's find some random dungeon people.
Grab the skeleton.
They're probably not going to participate.
Right.
No, we need it. To attempt to eat your bones.
We need it so we can cast higher level spells to kill you later. One thing I'll add as well, and you can, you know, push back on this, feel free to. I would have liked to have seen one free casting of this spell per day. Because it's a 6th level ability. I know you get something else at 6th level, which is that D6 to the spells cast through that we talked about way back. I think like 2 hours ago at this point. But it seems like a lot of effort just to learn a new spell for a long rest. You know,
I mean, the potential of a free 4th, 5th, or 6th level spell slot is pretty crazy.
Yeah, it is pretty good.
Then
I guess it doesn't matter. It just won't get any use because you already have all the spells that you need.
Yeah, like I said, I think probably the biggest thing you'd want to do is to get resurrection spells.
Yeah.
You know, as you get up there, like you could get raised dead 5th level resurrection spell.
Yep.
Or, you know, I'll do it every morning, have revivify if you have no way to get that.
There's otherwise. Also some cleric nukes in the necromancy school that aren't bad. Harm, obviously. 14d6.
I don't remember harm. That sounds fun.
It's the opposite.
Yeah, I don't know harm.
Oh, yeah. You mean the spell heal. Okay. What level is it, though?
It's 14d6. It's got to be up there.
Yeah, so you've got nukes that you don't normally have access to up there, but I think Kevin's right in that you're mainly going to be chasing after resurrection spells you don't have access to.
Sure.
Yeah.
And I can
mean, as you get up there, there are some, like Create Undead is a good spell to have access to in our mini campaign. My Hexblade, he had Create Undead, and that's how I was getting the ghouls.
Oh, I remember the
and
ghouls.
Like that, yeah, and that was like a pretty defining thing of that character.
Yeah, definitely. So I'll give it that, though it does take a while to get to those levels, obviously, because proficiency bonus does not follow level spell access. So you don't get fifth level proficiency, I think, or sorry, plus 5 proficiency until I want to say 14th level. I don't have that memorized, but I feel like I should by now.
13th,
thank you.
And then 6 level, plus 6 is 17th. I mean, so yeah, we're getting really up there.
Right.
Yeah. You could get Hunter's Mark. That's a divination spell.
Okay.
Something that's kind of, you know, that's all right.
That's probably not what you want to spend your concentration on.
Yeah. No. You just don't get enough attacks to make it worthwhile.
That's true.
So
yeah, say the high levels I'm seeing like True Scene, Soul Cage, like all good stuff. But that's again, 6th level spell, so 17th level character grabbing that stuff.
Right. And bards have the ability to do that whole take any spell off any list, right? Do they all get that or is that just Lore Bard? I forget.
Lore Bards get it early at 6th, and then additional magical secrets, and then the rest of them get it at 10th.
Okay.
And then quite a few times.
So I would probably argue that if you don't have a healer, somebody who has Revivify or any of those spells and such, you'll probably want to take that around 10th level anyways. 10th, 14th, and 18th, they get the option for that. Mm-hmm. So maybe it's not terribly useful to have it through this, but it's not bad either. Really, my only big issue is the whole you need a certain number of willing creatures in order to conduct this and get the level you want. I honestly would throw that out so quickly. Just up to your proficiency bonus, conduct your seance, include at least one other person for the flavor, because I think it'd be funny to try and rope in the paladin who's like, I don't want to worship any of this this devil stuff. I don't know what's going on here.
Right. If you could take cantrips, which I assume you can, you could take Toll the Dead. So, you know, that could be nice.
Great.
Yeah. Thanks.
That's what this class needed. Actually, that does fix a lot.
Yeah, actually, why doesn't this class get Toll the Dead?
Because bards don't get extra bard spells. It just it's not one of the things that those subclasses get.
It would also pair very well with their additional D6, yeah? Because it doesn't have material components, but we ignored that. We're ignoring the material components.
But if they make an attack?
No, it's just when you cast
a cast spell. A barrel. Okay.
So, that's all right. We'll say that it does, or it would add the D6. So, yes, taking Toll the Dead, if you had no other options, would be... good
even
damage.
If you have other options, that's like a pretty solid.
Hate how good Toll the Dead is.
Yeah, that's what it's a d12. It's a what, wisdom save?
Yes,
just add it up. Yeah, but it causes a d12 if as long as they've been hurt, and then it scales like any other cantrip
as long as they've been hurt. Like, it's such a dumb mechanic. The Ranger's Slayer's Prey, what is it? There's, I think, one of the hunter features or something. Colossus Slayer. That's it. Has the same thing where it's like, oh, if you're under max HP. I've heard people saying before that's a bit of a holdout from when bloodied was a condition. And that's how it used to be. Is once you're bloodied, or once they're bloodied, then you get this additional damage. That makes sense to me for Toll the Dead. Saying, oh, once you're at half HP, then you do this additional damage. That works. That's okay. There's times when things aren't below half HP, and Toll the Dead is not nearly as effective. But being just one HP below max, I'm sure we've gone on this rant before, but...
probably.
Yeah. I really don't like Toll the Dead for that. It's just a little too powerful.
Right.
All right, anything else around Spirit Session, just to make sure?
Nope.
Okay.
Small thumbs, let's round this out.
Yeah, all right, last one is Mystical Connection. So now you have the ability to nudge the spirits of tales from beyond towards certain tales. Whenever you roll on the spirit tales table, you can roll the dice twice, the die twice. Man, these are some tough combinations of words. You can choose which one you want to do. You roll twice, you choose the one you want. All right, Mystic Connection.
If you roll doubles, then you just choose anything on the
table. Whichever you want. Okay. Which gets harder and harder the higher level you get as a bard.
That's a fair point. At this point, you would already have the D12s.
Yeah.
They get a 15th. Yeah, okay.
So there's a level where you wouldn't have it. So,
I mean, this is fine. It's just too late.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking too.
You know, it does address the issues we were talking about with the randomness and all that. But 14th level is that's pretty late.
Campaign's over. I don't care anymore. I've already had 50 uses of this that burned me because I only rolled ones every single time throughout this campaign.
Right.
Which you're like, that wouldn't happen. Statistically speaking, that never happens. Statistically speaking, it happens every time.
Yeah.
I did the math. He's correct.
Yeah. So we did for our one shot yesterday. I played the Path of Wild Magic Barbarian, and I had four. It was just one long thing. I had four uses of my rage, and I rolled a 7 on that wild magic for 3 of them. And then that was one where it's like it becomes difficult terrain around you. And when I rolled them, they were all flying creatures.
Yeah,
yeah, it was very frustrating. It's like and what was. To prove my point here, though, I wasn't completely pissed and felt like I wasted everything because I was still a raging barbarian.
Right.
It's fine.
Right. Your worst case scenario is resistance to bludgeoning, piercing, and slashing, and +2 to every melee attack you made.
Right.
Wow. Or strength attack, sorry. It works on thrown,
yeah,
too.
Yeah. No, it doesn't.
Yeah, but it does. If it's a strength...
Strength-based melee attack.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Never mind. Barbarians suck now. All right. So that is all of the abilities. I will say I came around a little bit, but I still have too many issues with this to ever really consider playing it myself.
I think you're both being salty sailors because you're like living out this character you'll never play and getting burned by it. And you're like, oh, I'm so mad about this situation that it's happening in my head. But the reality of this is every morning you will do this. Some mornings mm-hmm. you'll get burned. But just in general, you are now a bard with one less inspiration die, which kind of sucks.
But at the same time, again, you start at fifth level, you start getting back on a short rest. I'm pretty sure it's fifth.
Correct, fifth.
Which is nice. Yeah. And being a bard is like, I mean, bards are great, just like the base bard class. They get a lot of good spells.
Are they though, Kevin?
They are. This is not 3.5 or whatever. Bards are great at fifth edition.
Yes, this is another joke.
Expertise. Yeah.
This is
the jack of all trades.
Yeah.
You still get your regular bardic inspiration you could use. Magical secrets at higher level. Folk spellcaster. Light armor. It's great.
Yeah. So, you know, it's a little less terrible than I think I initially came in with. Honestly, I hate to say it, but the flavor saves it a lot for me because I really, really like the flavor of it. And I said at the mm-hmm. beginning, I like when we have these classes that are like, hey, here's the established pattern of a bard who sings, or they are, you know, I don't know, part of a college of some sort. And this just kind of shakes it up entirely of what right. a bard can be and where they pull from the weave. So that's a big plus to me, and I don't know, I guess I would want to see how this plays out in a long-term campaign.
Yeah, I want to play this kind of, but I've also played so many bards and I kind of want to move on from bards, so someone else play it.
I am not allowed to be a player for more than one session at a time, so
right.
A new warlock subclass. I can't not play the new warlock, Kevin.
Right.
We have to lean into our stereotypes.
I think your next character, Will, needs to be a warlock. I need to do some patron fuckery with you. Never had that opportunity to really make it important. So I'm going to make your life hell. Just like I'm making our current warlock's life hell.
That's half the fun.
Exactly.
Yeah. So yeah, I'm glad we did this episode and we sat down and we really talked it through and took the probably close to an hour and a half. Because I did, definitely did. Come around a bit.
All right.
So I am more open to it. So yeah, this is one I want to hear if people have played it as for more than just a one shot, because with the randomness, a one shot could just be absolutely amazing or absolutely terrible over a longer campaign.
Yeah. So now,
I guess no one would have yet, but
at the beginning of the episode, I said like, hey, if you really love this class, maybe just turn this off. Just put a disclaimer on there. Or just take that out. Just take that out. Yeah. Like, listen to it. There's some nuance to the conversation and you should be a part of it. How about that?
Yeah.
Put that as the cold open. That way the people at the beginning know. Otherwise, I think we can close the book on this. I will say I do like the connection to music with bards. And I think my favorite way of doing that is by using Bardly. Because Bardly is a service that can allow you to bring music seamlessly into your games. Choose from hundreds of different tracks to fit the specific scenario that you're in. No more searching through on YouTube for the perfect playlist of your gothic horror setting. You just go into Bardly, put in the right settings, and boom, you've got an entire playlist curated for you. I've been using it for months, absolutely love it, and you can go ahead and get 50% off your 3-month subscription using the code MNM10, 50, MNM50. really just got to condense everything into one code because this brain can't store it all. Too much D&D rules in here. So, yeah, fantastic service. Been loving it. And even though we're in person now, it's really, really useful for online. It's also been great for in person, as I can just kind of have it up on a different tab on my tablet, switch around really easily. When combat gets started, change the lights, change the music. It's go time. And otherwise, this is the end of the episode. So I have to say all the things about liking and subscribing. So if you are not yet, make sure to like, subscribe, ring the bell, leave comments, subscribe wherever you get your podcasts. If you're listening to the podcast, if you didn't know we had a podcast, check out the podcast. If you don't like it on YouTube, if you're listening to the podcast and didn't know we had it on YouTube, check us out on YouTube. There's millions of ways to get your entertainment, as long as it's one of those two options. As usual, you can support the show by going to monstersandmulticlass.com/support, where you can check out our affiliates, get some awesome deals on Dice, Bardley, as mentioned, as well as Describe, and also join our Patreon. And thank you to our Patreon subs, which is Jeth W, Joe P, Vincent M, Isaac M, Sentinel D20, Star Shinobi, Adam A, and Home Bakery. You're all amazing, and we love you. And that's it. That's the show. That's the episode.
Do I get to say my line now?
Maybe just because everybody's waiting around for it. You know, they hear the promotional aspect and they're like, ooh,
thanks for watching.
They're like, I wanna.
He did it.
It doesn't count when Will says it. It's not okay. As good. But the people stick around. The people stick around and they're waiting and they're like, oh, when's he gonna say it? When's Kevin gonna say it? And then finally, the tension's built to its climax, and he says.
I kind of feel like a little kid with this, like, where I'm, like, given, like, the one simple task at the end, get all excited and giddy to be able to help out, which is, like, a minor little thing. So, yeah, thanks for listening. I did it.